Hi everyone. In fact, in the last week we were discussing about the module 4 of the computer network and security. In the module 4 we talk about the security of the network system, wherein there are certain threats that are expected from the network system. There are four main kind of threats we can expect in the network. You can see the first one is the DNS hacking, the most dangerous, and then the routing table poisoning. Again, it will disturb the entire network system because of the poisoning of the router's table, and then the packet mistreat. It is another kind which will be an attack over the packets. All these three techniques are called as network infrastructural threats on the network security. And the final one is the denial of services. This will be an attack over the end system. However, we were discussed the DNS hacking and also the routing table poisoning in detail in the last class. Today we'll be discussing on the packet mistreats and also on the denial of service. Yeah, look at this packet mistreatment attack. This is an attack over the packets. Usually, whenever there is a transmission of packets are going on in the network, the attack over the packets will be take place. And of course, the hacker will capture the data packets, and they will be mistreating onto these data packets. The data packet will be having the two segments in it. Okay, the first one is the header and the body. So this header and this body, so header will be having the information about the communication, might be having the port address, the sequence number, the timestamp. Likewise, it will be also some flags will be there in this, and these informations are very, very important to deliver this packet to the expected destination. If there is any correction or changes over this one, will lead to the improper communication of the packet. I think that is where they are trying to attack here. Okay? So this attack on the packets will lead to a congestion in the network. Because they will be trying to create a lot of packets generation, and that may lead to the congestion. Also, they will see that the throughput of that network is go down because of the reasons that the packet is not reached the expected destination. Rather, it might be changed its direction so that the movement of the packet will not be able to reach the destination, and hence finally the throughput of the entire network will go down. And after that, there is a possibility of denial of service attack also. The denial of service attack is an attack over the end systems. Okay, so end system will be identified, and it will be made an attack over the packets of this end system, so that the end system will be unable to give deliver service to anybody, and also the end system itself will be in trouble. So these are the possibilities of this attack, and these attacks can also be either on link attacks or on the router attacks. So as we were discussed even in the previous discussion, that the link attacks are over the links of the connectivity in the network. And routers are the hubs where exactly the routing of packet will be to take place. Okay, so these two areas are very critical, and wherein this packet mistreatment attack will be done. Now look at the different possible troubles that could have been occurred because of the mistreat of packet. The first one is an interruption. The second one is the modification, replication of the packets, the pinch of death. I think it's a very, very interesting one also. And then there is a malicious misrouting of the packet. These are some variations over the packet communication, and of course these will always be a trouble. Let us look at each one in detail. The first one we are talking about the interruption. You see this interruption is basically it will interrupt the propagation of the packet to the destination. Basically what they are trying to do is they will attack onto the header of the packet. So the header will have the information regarding the source and destination address. So the destination address is an indicator for the next hop to forward this packet to the next level. So if this destination address is changed, then what happens? So obviously the packet may not go to the expected destination, rather it might be redirected to some other location or put in the application. Obviously this will lead to loss of throughput in the network. You know, the throughput, we talked the throughput as the number of packets that have been received against the number of packets delivered. So obviously the packets will not reach the destination, and hence it will lead to lower the throughput of the network. So this is one dangerous thing, and we have to give protection for such possible attacks in the network. The second possibility is the modification. The attacker may try to modify the content of this packet. As I was told, there are two segments in the packet. One is an header, another one is the body or payload, what we say. There might be an modification on the either on the header side or on the body side. If they do any modification in the body, the data is altered. If the data is altered, the receiver or the expected user of this data may not be receiving the accurate data. Rather, he will be leading to the misleading to the other kind of data. So that is the biggest problem in this case. The other way is, if they do some corrections or modification in the header, so there are different possibilities. I think one could be denial of service, and otherwise it may lead to the looping in the network, or otherwise it may die out in the network. Die out means the packet will be reaching the destination with a very long time, so that it may not be accepted in the receiver side. So likewise, these could be the different possible problems or the expected problems in the network due to the modification of the content of the packet. And this problem can be overcome by means of a special technique called digital signature mechanism, which we will be discussing in detail in the next. Right now, you see one more possibility with the packet mistreatment. The possibility is replication of the packets. You know, the attacker will be capturing the actual packet in the network. Okay, once he captures, he will duplicate this one. The same packet is duplicated and it is spread into the network. So the moment he will duplicate it, what happens is the packets with the same destination address and with the same content will reach to the destination. Okay, so lot many packets will move, and this will lead to the receiver is unable to receive these packets effectively. Okay, so finally, this receiver will lead to a condition of denial of service. You see that any different type of attack, finally it will lead to the problem to the end system, okay, or otherwise sometimes it may be making the network busy. So the other possibility is it will make the network busy. Okay, the traffic of the network is increased so that the network is busy, which further lead to the lower throughput in the network. See, finally, they will try to disturb the network, and hence both the users and also the network system managers will be troubled by this one. I think the replication is one of the biggest challenges, and that is supposed to be identified by means of sequence number. How can we identify the repetition? The solution is sequence number. If the same sequence numbered packet is repeated number of times, okay, then you caught hold that there is a replication of this packet by an attacker, so that you can diagnose the issue and you can try to avoid the possible consequences of this issue. Okay, so this is the another category of the attack. And the next category of attack is pinch of death. I think you must be knowing that we will pinch the message into the network in order to understand the availability of the destination. And of course, this pinching message, which is large in size, and it will be fragmented number of times. So whenever the ping message is too long and it has been fragmented to a large number, so that what happens, for the same packet, the receiver will be receiving number of fragments, and it is an uncontinuous reception of this fragment will lead to a problem at the receiver. He has to reassemble all these fragments of the pinch packet, and the packet length becomes too large, and it may cause the system to crash, because it is supposed to keep track of every fragment and try to reassemble at the receiving point. There might be a problem, a possibility that the primary memory is overloaded. Okay, it may attack on the primary memory of the receiver, and this may lead to crash of the system. So you believe it or not, the things are very, very simple here. The attack type is very simple, but however, the cause of this attack will be very high. So that's why these sort of attacks are supposed to be diagnosed and supposed to be blocked or trapped at the earliest. In order to identify this kind of an attack, what we need to do is, if the pinch message with too many fragments, then immediately you try to suspect on that, and you can identify the possible attack on that. The next one is the malicious misrouting of the packets. Obviously, here till now what we discussed is of link level attack. At the link point, they will be capturing the packet, and after capturing the packet, they will be trying to do the attack on the network by so many means. What we said, there might be a chance of replication or pinch of death, or it might be the change in the modification of the content of the packet, like that. So now you can look at this malicious misrouting is the attack at the router level. What they do is, the packet is attacked and the hacker is trying to change the routing table information. You know, earlier we discussed that there is an UDP packets are circulated in the network by the driver information is supposed to be learned by means of these packets only. So that's the reason. Finally, what happens is, these packets that are trying to learn about the neighbors, that itself will be operated, and there will be a change in data packet and causing denial of service. So this is the biggest problem. Finally, the routing table is disturbed. And once the routing table is disturbed, I think earlier we have discussed what are the possible causes because of the disturbance in the routing table. So all these are supposed to be handled very, very seriously and effectively so that the possible problem can be overcome at the earliest. I think we discussed five different techniques that can be adopted for packet mistreatment, and these attacks are supposed to be taken care by the network system. It is an attack which is frequently happen in the network system. Basically, this type of an attack is called as an end system attack. End system attack means either it will be an attack over the source machine or on the destination machine. Let me give an example on this. The attack on destination machine might be like this. You are the student of VTU, and on the day of VTU result, if an attacker attacks on the server of the VTU, and he will be pinging with a lengthy segments, or otherwise he may be doing lot many other changes in the routing operation towards the, he may route all the packets of the network into the same VTU server, so that the unwanted or unprivileged packets will move into the VTU server. So the moment they will move to the VTU server, the VTU server becomes busy for no reason. Okay, so this busy of a VTU server will hamper the performance of this server, and finally the genuine users of this server, that is the students of VTU, are unable to access the VTU server. So this is an attack at the destination machine, or the server attack. Okay, so this is happening in the network most oftenly, and this is supposed to be really understood by means of gateways and other securities that can be adopted for servers, so that the problem to the regular usage might be overcome. So what exactly happens with the denial of service? It prohibits the user from accessing the normally provided services. That's what I told, I think, with the example of the VTU server. Denial of service does not result in information theft. They are not really interested in getting any information from the server or any machine, but they just want to make a trouble to the people. Okay. By this trouble, what finally happens is a large amount of time and money is lost in the network, isn't it? Because the people who are accessing the VTU server, they are spending money on the internet bandwidth. Okay, that is lost, and they lose their time in accessing the VTU server number of times. Okay, so this is the biggest problem that could have happened with the denial of service. The attacks affect on the destination. That's what I told you. So it will be an end system attack. Obviously, it is an attack at the either server or any machine at the destination point. One of the possibility is rushing the number of packets, duplicated packets into the server. This will attack on the specific network services also. For example, there might be a Yahoo server. Yahoo server is known for the email service. If they do an attack on the Yahoo server, the email service may be hampered. They may attack on the DNS server. Okay, you know, DNS server is very, very important for any communication in the network. Every communication will first make a request to the DNS server to get the IP address of the destination, and then it will forward the packet. So once the DNS is failed, the most services of the network will be failed. Okay, Like the other possibility is buffer overflow. As I told, there will be duplicated packets rushed into a single system. So the buffer in the destination might be overflown. And it is all possible because they insert an executable code in the memory. Okay. So they might be insert some executable codes in the memory, and hence they will poison the entire system. This may use the number of tools for sending large number of queries to the DNS server. So I think you must be knowing that the SQL servers will also be giving service by doing the queries for different requirement. All that will be affected by this. And it is easy to generate, but difficult to detect. The biggest problem of this kind of attack is attacker will do his job very easily. But however, the rectifying this is very difficult, because detecting the problem itself or detecting the root cause itself is very, very difficult. And it will take a few hours to take action on that. So in the meantime, a major damage might have took place. Some examples are UDP flood, the TCP flood, and also the ICMP flood. I think these are some well-known issues that may happen in the denial of service. There are two categories of denial of service attacks. The first one is a single source attack. The other one is distributed. In the single source attack, what happens? This attack is done by a single machine. Okay, so this is attacking onto the network by sending lot many packets, generating lot many unwanted packets, and it will try to make the destination machine overwhelmed by the receiving number of such packets, and finally it will be blocking the service. It loses the throughput in the network. Okay, so that's the single source problem. The other one is the distributed one. A large number of hosts are used to flood unwanted traffic to a single target. Target is single, but however, the flood is created from different users. Okay, so they learn about this target, and they will be using different machines from different point of geographical location in the network, and they will flood the packets into the single destination. Finally, this destination will fail to give service to the people, and hence it is called denial of service. I think these are the two basic issues that can happen. You look into the denial of service attacks. The flood may be either a UDP flood, or it could be an TCP SYN flood. I hope you all know about the SYN packet. SYN stands for the synchronization in case of TCP. This we will use during the connection establishment between the source and destination. Okay, connection establishment is done with the SYN packet. So during this path establishment, the TCP SYN packets are generated. So what the attacker does here is, he will generate either the UDP packets in a large number or the TCP SYN packets in large number. And all these packets will be rushed to the same destination. Okay. So when a large number of packets are received at a very faster rate, the receiver will be in a chaos. How to give a service, and because all will be of a similar kind. And you know, the TCP SYN, large number of requests will go to the destination, and for that the machine will respond saying that by sending an acknowledgement. Okay, but for the same source point, large many SYN requests and large many acknowledgement are created, and finally the processing of these packets becomes very, very difficult for this, and the system will fail. This is what is the basic intention of the attacker. Here he wants to see that the end user system is going to fail to give the service. His intention is more rarely in collecting the data, rather is his intention is to trouble the people. Okay, that's the reason it's very, very important for us to identify denial of service attacks and try to give a protection to your system. These are possible. How can we rectify the denial of service? I think denial of service can be handled even by some gateway means. So gateway will have the proxy. The proxy can read all the packets, and then it can identify any such spoofing can be detected, and it can be blocked or filtered at the earliest, so that the problem that could have been caused due to this kind of an attack can be overcome. So other than this, there are other softwares that will be used to learn about these kind of attacks, and they can give the solution for blocking such packets. So this is all about the denial of service attack. I think we discussed four different type of attacks, and we learned how these attacks are made. Let us look into the other overviews of the security methods. How can we protect our system when we have all these kind of threats in the network? So how can we protect our system? Basically, there is a crypto science in the network system, which will be really giving for a solution for this kind of threats in the network. What is this cryptography says? It is basically a science and art of transferring message to a secured and immune attack. Secure transmission and immunity to the attack. This is possible by the cryptography. So I think a lot of techniques have been evolved in the cryptography. And because of this reason, we could able to protect our network and also the systems from all these kind of attack. Secondly, the cryptography will process transferring a piece of information or a message into a code. Okay, how exactly it will protect it? It will convert from one form to the another form. You believe it or not, there are a lot many thousands of techniques have been adopted. And so that whatever the data that is being transmitted will be an coded one, so that which the person may not be able to, attacker may not be able to read it. For example, I will tell you one an example to you. Earlier days, I think the kings of one country and the other country, if they have, they are in good terms, they used to make the communication through the pigeons. I think that is where the cryptography has started. Okay, they used to use the pigeon. They used to write some message, coded message in either in a cloth or something, and that will be tied to the legs of the pigeon, and the pigeon is sent to the other kingdom. So where the other kingdom will receive the message of this, okay, he will decode it and then he will read. Okay, so what is the need of this one? The need of this one is, if anybody catch hold this pigeon in between and they are trying to read this message, they are unable to read it because they don't know how to decode this message. Okay, so decoding is a problem for them. But however, this person is knowing that. How they know? Very simple. They know the method how they have coded so that they can decode it very effectively. Let me give an example how this coding and decoding is done. For example, I will transmit in the digital media right now, this data. What is this? This represent number 8. When this number is transmitted, it will not be transmitted as number 8, rather it will be transmitted as 001. Okay, actually the value of 001 is 1. When this is transmitted to the destination, okay, the destination person will receive the number 1, okay, and the code of this one is 001. He will convert this into 1000 and he will read this data as 8 finally. Why? Because he knows that how exactly this coding is done at the source point, and he will decode by reversing the same operation here. Okay, because he is an authenticated user. Let us assume that there is an unauthorized person who is accessing this one. What ultimately he will read? He will read the data 1. He doesn't know what is 1. It might be a number 1, but do you think that is the right content of that communication? No, it's a wrong communication, and hence the data what he received will not be a proper one. But now let us understand how this coding is done here. Very simple. They have rotated this bit by 4 times. Right on rotation, ROR, for 4 times. Okay, so then, sorry, right on rotation for 1 time, 1 bit rotation. So then it has become this. So that's the reason what these people will do is, again, they do right on rotation by 1 bit so that they will get back this digit and they can open, read it as 8. So now what is the key in this? The key is right on rotate by 1 bit. So this key information must be known to both the sender and the receiver. If they know it, then they can definitely do it in an effective way. The decoding can be done and they can read it properly. However, the person who reads this will be unable to read this data properly, and that is the failure of the accessing the data. Hope you understood the basic techniques that are adopted in the cryptography. Here one such an example. Usually the coding what we do at the sending point, okay, that coding at the sending point is called as encryption. What is it called? Encryption. Okay, so this encryption will always have some mathematical technique, and using that technique they do the encryption. Okay, this we call as key. Such a technique is called as key. Here we'll take one such an example. Here you see the data that has been transmitted here is A to Z alphabets, small alphabets. Okay, when it is received on the other side, it has been received in this form. Okay, it has been received this form. However, they will convert it back to the original by knowing how exactly they have done this conversion. Very simple. Here what is the message is converted is, this A is replaced by M, B is replaced by N, C is replaced by O, D is replaced by P. So likewise, every letter or character is replaced by the next letter to the on the other side. So this kind of an conversion will lead to this possible text. Now what we call this original text, it is called as plain text. It is called as plain text. After decoding it, coding it, it becomes an cipher text. The plain text is called a readable one. Okay, It is a readable text, and the cipher text is called non-readable text. For example, I may write one I love India. This I love India, I will replace by the next letters. After I, we have J. After L, we have M. After O, we have the P. After V, we have W. After E, we have the F. And after I, we have the J. After N, we have the O. After D, we have E. After I, we have J. After A, it is B. You see this, I love India has become J, M, P, W, F, J, O, E, J, B. Can you read this message? No. This is called ciphertext. Okay. A non-readable message is called ciphertext, and the original message is called readable message. Okay. So this is how exactly one of the best techniques that are used for this one. Anyway, the encryption key is how we are converted. Here I have just converted by replacing the original letter by the next letter in the alphabet series. Okay. I think there are so many such illustrations we can give, and that is how exactly the encryption is done. There's one more an example you can see here. What is that is n substitution ciphers. So there will be a cycle patterning. It means after every data, a pattern of message will be added to it, and then it is transmitted. Okay. You can see that after the message, a pattern of text or message is added to it, and then it is transmitted. Okay. So obviously the reader or hacker cannot read it properly. Only the person who is reading on the other side will remove after every message, first message, will remove the next four, and again he will read the next message, he will remove the next four. Like this, he will do that decryption, and hence he could be able to read the data in a proper. So this is another way of doing the encryption. So here, what is the encryption key? The encryption key is n substitution cipher and cyclic pattern. Okay, so this is the other way we can do the encryption. So looking at this cryptographic techniques, now we will come to understand how exactly this is processed. You look at this diagram here. At each and every point of your the node or the router, we will be having a kind of an system. You can see that this end system is followed by an encryption technique. Okay, and then it is forwarded at every node, other node like router and all. Again, there will be a decryption, and when it is sending out, it will be doing the encryption, and then it is forwarded. Again, at the next hop, decryption is done, and then when it is sending out, it will do the encryption, decryption, encryption. Okay, decryption, encryption, decryption, encryption. Okay, in inbound link will be doing the decryption, outbound link will be doing the encryption. So this is the way they will do the decryption and the encryption, so that the network can be maintained it as the here it is encrypted, and here it is decrypted finally at the server B. So this is how the encryption and decryption is done, and basically the message is encrypted with the help of a key, And most of the time, this encryption is done by means of exclusive OR operation. What this is? XOR operation. Okay, you know the XOR operation. If M is 1 and K is 0, what is the XOR operation of these two? 1. So XOR says if both inputs are same, then output is 0. If inputs are different, then output is 1. So this is the basic formula in XOR operation. For example, I'll give one more example. So both are different. So 1, both are different, 1, 1, both are same, 0. This is the XOR operation over these two bits. Okay. So this is how exactly we do the XOR operation. You see that this is the formula. Okay, we do XOR operation at the encryption between the message and the key. At the receiving point, decryption is very, very simple because it is a mathematical operation. So what we do is the encrypted data, this is M XOR with K, will be XOR with K once again, because the key is also known to the receiver. So once he does the XOR operation with the encrypted data, he will get back the actual original message. So this is the beauty of this. I think you'll be knowing the reason how exactly it will work. Right, I think the basic method, the plain text is encrypted with a key, and then a cipher text is developed and it is transmitted in the network. At the receiving point, they do the decryption with the help of again key, and finally they read the plain text. I think the best illustration for the cryptographic techniques. Yeah, I think in a cryptographic technique there are two methods. One is using of a secret key, the other one is using of the public key. Secret key is also called as symmetric encryption. The reason, both at the sender and receiver point, we use the same key, and hence it is called the secret key. So why it is called secret key? Very simple. This key is shared between sender and receiver. Shared between the sender and the receiver. So sender will encrypt with that key, receiver will decrypt with that key. So that is why it is called symmetric encryption. The public key is something different. In the public key encryption, the sender will do the encryption with one key, the receiver will use another key, and both will be different. And it is more powerful also, and it will have a better security indeed. The drawback of public key is, its operation is very slow because it will be a very lengthy in nature, and it will take much time to process it. As I told, the complexity of such encryption and decryption is too high, and hence it will consume a lot of computational energy. And it is sometimes it may not be practical also, because I am using a small gadget like a mobile, and it whose capacity of processing is very, very less. In that case, if I am trying to use the complex encryption technique, so that complex encryption technique will really trouble my system, so that system may hang sometimes. So it is better to avoid such complex computations. And it will be used to establish the session to exchange the session key. I think there will be an additional session is between the sender and receiver to exchange their sessions. Next, we will be discussing on the authentication techniques in the next class. Till now, we discussed about the different threats that are possible, and how to overcome this threat by means of encryption. The encryption will adopt different techniques, and the encryption will help us to find out the best solution for the possible problem in the network system. With this, I am going to conclude this session, and I wish all of you learned about this the threats in the network. You are also supposed to be very careful when you are using your communication in the network, because any communication in the network will be having this kind of threat. Nowadays, attacks are different kind than what we discussed here, and there will be a lot of security issues. You might have sent a message with a link, and if you just click on that link in the message, definitely your device will be downloading some information at the background without your knowledge, and finally that will attack on your system. The attack may be immediately known, or it may be learned after some time. Okay, so that's why it's very difficult to identify such attack and to recover from the attack. Most of the time you may lose your data in the devices, so that's why it's very important you to learn about these security issues and to take precaution over the such attacks. With this message, I would like to stop my discussion here today. In the next class, we will be discussing about the authentication techniques, and also we'll be discussing on the different techniques or examples where we can continue with the possible discussion of correcting the learning the what we say the encryption and decryption process. So this thank you very much. We will join soon. Thank you.